This is Thomas B. Warren, and I want you to know that I'm certainly delighted that you're in our audience today. It's such a wonderful privilege as we live in a nation where the Bible is readily available to any and everyone who wishes to have one. And it's such a pleasure to realize that we can take the Bible and study it, learn it, and come to know what it teaches and thereby be saved. And I'd like to plead with you to take your own Bible. And as I go through these various things that we'll talk about today, that you will be as noble as were the people of Berea of old, as we read in Acts chapter 17 and verse 11, where the Bible says of the Bereans that they were more noble than they of Thessalonica. And why were they more noble than they of Thessalonica? The Bible tells us it was because they searched the Scriptures daily to see if these things were so. And so I urge you to take your Bible and test what I tell you the Bible teaches and see for yourself whether or not it is so. Now today I want to study with you a lesson that I regard as very, very important, and I hope that you will too. It's entitled, Do We Have the Right to Be Wrong? Do we have the right to be wrong? I'm not talking about just ordinary affairs of life. I'm talking about what the Bible teaches. Do we have the right to be wrong? Do we have the right to draw the wrong conclusions as to what the Bible teaches us to do to be saved? Of what particular religious organization we ought to be members of? And what we should do in worship and so forth? Let us study this together as friends and neighbors who love one another and who want to help one another, as I certainly want to help everyone in our audience. And if you can see something that I'm teaching that's not according to the sacred will of God, I would count you my friend if you would write to me and let me know. The address will be given near the end of the program. I suggest to you, first of all, that we do not have the right to be wrong about God, about faith in God, about believing in God. Now, I call your attention to a passage of Scripture found in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11 and verse 6. Now, notice how this passage reads. Without faith, notice that carefully. Without faith, it is impossible to be well-pleasing unto God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Now notice, there are no big words in that passage. There's no complicated grammar. There is no need for you to be a scholar in grammar or Greek or Hebrew or anything of that sort. It's just a plain, simple statement that we all can understand. What does it say? Without faith, that is, without faith in God, it is impossible to be well-pleasing unto God. Now, what does it mean, impossible? Well, it means you just can't do it. That's what it means, and we all know that. You simply cannot be pleasing to God without believing in Him, without faith in Him, without trusting Him. And what does it mean to trust Him? It means to take Him at His word. As we read in Romans chapter 4, verses 20 and 21, in regard to that great man of the Old Testament, Abraham, where it says that he wavered not through unbelief, but was fully persuaded, notice that, fully persuaded that what God had promised, he was able also to perform. Now that simply means that when you come to the Bible, you have the attitude, now if the Bible says that something is necessary, then I will regard it as necessary, and I will bring my life into harmony with it. But if the Bible says that I'm not to do something, then I will not do it because I trust in God. Now, friends, there's no way you can trust in God without trusting in His Word. Only those who obey His Word are the people who really have faith in Him. In Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, it says, Trust in the Lord, how? With all thine heart, and not lean on what? And lean not unto thine own understanding. How should we acknowledge God? In all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct thy paths. So you see, there is the necessity of our trusting in God, and we do that by taking Him at His word, and that means that we study the Bible, learn what it teaches, and then we obey it. So, do we have the right to be wrong about faith in God? No, we do not. The Bible plainly and unequivocally, without any doubt at all, teaches that we must be right about God. Now let us notice the next question that we shall consider. Do we have the right to be wrong about faith in Jesus Christ? The Bible answer is no, we do not. Let me say it clearly. We do not, according to Bible teaching, have the right to be wrong about faith in Jesus Christ. In a conversation, actually a dispute with the Jews, Jesus said, "Except ye believe that I am He, ye shall die in your sins." Now, Jesus says that in substance to every one of us today. Just as if He pointed His finger at us and said, "Except you believe that I am He, ye shall die in your sins." You have only this lifetime to make up your mind about whether you will believe in God and His Son, Jesus Christ. Whether you can be saved by the grace of God depends upon your believing in God and believing in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. Notice again how simple is the language. There's not one thing that's hard to understand in that passage. "Except ye believe that I am He," that is the Son of God, said Jesus, "ye shall die in your sins." And what if you die in your sins? Then you will suffer everlasting punishment. Matthew chapter 25 and verse 46. That's how serious are the matters about which we're speaking today. There are a lot of things that are important in our lives, but there's nothing as important as you're learning, as you're loving the truth, learning the truth, submitting your life to it, obeying it. You do not have the right, none of us does, to be wrong about faith in Jesus Christ. And so, in the next point, one very closely akin to the two that we have already looked at. We do not have the right to be wrong about believing the gospel. Now, in the final words, among at least the final words that Jesus spoke before He ascended back to the Father, is recorded in the last few verses of the Gospel of Mark. He said in the giving of the Great Commission to His apostles, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel." Notice He didn't say go out and preach some religious message. He didn't say go out and preach a religious message. But He said, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel." My friends, the gospel is this right here, the New Testament. It's not some creed book. There are more than 300 denominations in America alone that claim to be following Christ. But my friends, the only ones who are really following Christ are those who believe and obey the gospel. You do not have the right to be wrong about believing the gospel. I want to read to you, if you'll turn in your Bible to Galatians chapter 1, and let's read together verses 6 to 9. Now, I'm reading from the American Standard Version, which of course is simply a slight revision of the King James Version. And if you have the King James, it'll be just fine. Let's begin reading at verse 6 in Galatians chapter 1. "I marvel that ye are so quickly removing from Him that called you in the grace of Christ." See, the grace of Christ is involved in our being called to a certain message. "Unto a different gospel, which is not another gospel." It's not a message that will save, it's a message that will damn your soul. Any gospel other than the gospel of Christ will do that. It will damn your soul, it won't save you. There is no middle ground between the gospel and every false doctrine in the world. Paul goes on to say here, as he's guided with the Holy Spirit, "Only there are some that would trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ." But now notice carefully. "But though we," that is as an apostle, Paul was an apostle, "though we are an angel from heaven, should preach unto you any gospel other than that which we preached unto you, let him be anathema." Let him be accursed. As we have said before, so say I now again. If any man preacheth unto you any gospel other than that which he received, let him be anathema. Notice again the simplicity of the language, how easily understood it is. Here he's saying, here's another gospel. A man comes along, he preaches you a message that is not taught by this book. The tendency of people today is to say, oh, well, one message is good as another, one faith is good as another, we're all going to heaven by different roads. That is not the truth of God, it is the lie of Satan. Paul here, guided by the Holy Spirit, said, if anybody preaches any other message, even an apostle or an angel, the curse of God would rest upon him. But the gospel of Christ is that which will save. Paul said in Romans chapter 1, beginning with verse 15, "I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel. For it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes."